Please, this is Lana. She is a technical writer at Rackspace, and she's going to talk to us about content as a driver of change. Please put your hands together for Lana.
Can everyone hear me okay? Excellent. So humans have always told stories. And I've always dropped my laptop. This lovely group of people here in this room, I can see our phones, our laptops. I'm sure there's a tablet in there somewhere, our gorgeous cameras, our vanity email accounts, our amazing blogging platforms, all the rest. We're all still just humans telling stories. We're doing it with different tools, though. The original owners of the land we're standing on today are the Muwinina people. I do hope I pronounced that correctly. And we pay respect to those who have passed before us, and we acknowledge today's Tasmanian Aboriginal community who are the custodians of this land. Australian Indigenous art is the oldest unbroken tradition of art in the world. These weren't just the prehistory versions of sticking a Monet print on your lounge room wall, though. Indigenous art exists on all manner of things. Paintings on leaves, wooden rock carvings, sculptures, and of course, the more familiar cave drawings. This art gave early Australians a way to record the things that mattered most to them in their lives. They include scenes of hunts, special ceremonies. Many include megafauna and other extinct species. Many also include the arrival of European ships, which I find fascinating. More than a record of events, though, they were probably also a method of teaching. Each Indigenous tribe has its own mythology, which collectively in English we refer to as the dreaming. The Dreamtime stories use stories to convey morals and other educational information. Who here grew up in Australia? I reckon most of you would be familiar with the story of Tiddalik the Frog. Who remembers Tiddalik the Frog? Excellent. For those who don't know the story, Tiddalik the Frog, very, very basically and without going into too much detail, Tiddalik the Frog was a very greedy frog. He was very thirsty and he drank all the water in the land. And all the other animals wanted to drink something too. They were very thirsty. And what they had to do, they decided, to make the water come back was to tickle Tiddalik the Frog until he laughed. And when he laughed and laughed and he filled the rivers back up. I love this story. It's a fable about greed, but more than that, it's a fable about finding humor in bad situations. This is a complicated story. It has quite a lot to it. And these fables and the Indigenous art and the stories that lie behind the Dreamtime fables, are really just an early technical manual for life itself. Let's move on. Who here, talking about stories, who here remembers the story of Archimedes and his bath? Most of us, excellent. So the story of Archimedes and his bath is a demonstration, of course, of how Archimedes used water displacement to measure the density of an object. In the story, it was the king's crown. He was trying to determine how much gold was in it. That's not the bit we remember about that story, though, is it? The bit we remember about that story is that Archimedes, having made his discovery in the bath, goes running naked through the streets of Syracuse, yelling, "Eureka! Eureka! I have found it!" The reason we know this story is because it comes from us from a book called The De Architectura, which I'm sure I've mispronounced, by a man of the name Marcus Vitruvius Pollio. It was published around 15 BC. And it is arguably the oldest surviving technical manual in the world. Of course, the ancient Greeks and Romans were very well known for their literature, their scholars, and their philosophers. But they were possibly even better well known for their library. The Royal Library of Alexandria in Egypt was the largest repository of knowledge in the world in between 3 and 30 BC. That's a long time. Basically, the way I see it, it was the BC version of the internet. The famous fire that destroyed the Library of Alexandria was actually, well, probably set by Julius Caesar in around 48 BC. The library actually continued in some capacity after that until the Roman Emperor Aurelian destroyed what remained, which probably wasn't all that much, in around 270 AD, so quite some time later. This was, of course, a massive blow to literature, but it was also an incredible loss of technical data. Thankfully, the ancients did manage to hang on to a lot of these documents even after the library was destroyed, and we now have surviving copies of wonderful pieces like Pliny's Naturalis Historia, which I'm sure you've heard of, which is essentially the world's very first natural history encyclopedia, as well as things like the De Architectura. These documents have set the stage, as far as I see it, for modern technical manuals to come. So moving on. Gutenberg did his thing with the printing press in the mid-1400s. I promised not to bang on about Gutenberg as much as I could. Printed books, though, even then, were still terrifically rare and expensive things until well into the 15 and 1600s. Up until then, if you were a fairly ordinary person in a fairly ordinary European town, you were probably aware of the existence of almost exactly one book. Like to guess? The Bible. The Bible would have been sitting on a plinth in your church. You probably wouldn't be able to read. If you could read, you probably wouldn't be able to read the particularly stuffy version of Latin that the Bible was written in. And if you could read the particularly stuffy version of Latin that the Bible was written in, guess what? You weren't allowed to touch it. The Bible was the word of God. And as such, only men of the cloth, and they were all men, were allowed to read it and interpret it. They certainly didn't want normal people going off and reading the Bible and drawing their own conclusions about things. Of course, where that got really interesting is when the Reformation got fully underway, around the mid-1500s, people did actually start to read the Bible for themselves. Of course, Henry VIII famously got very upset about all this, and for a while there in England, he decided that ordinary folk, and naturally all women, were banned from reading the Bible. You know, all this running around and learning things and thinking your own thoughts was certainly not something old Henry liked, and we all know what happened when you disagreed with something that Henry thought. Moving on. Still in Europe, with better access to mass printing, publishing written versions of early verbal history became the thing to do. So I'm sure we've all heard of the Brothers Grimm. They were publishing in German in the early 1800s, but they weren't the first, not by a long way. Charles Perrault is generally considered to be the original author of many of the Disney favourites. He is considered the Disney favourites that he penned include Cinderella, Little Red Riding Hood, and Sleeping Beauty, so the ones we all know. And so Perrault was writing in French over a century before the Grimms were doing their thing in German. So it was around the late 1600s. Even he was just writing down stories that he'd heard elsewhere, though. So these stories were particularly gruesome before Disney got a hold of them. They were, in many cases, intended to be fables for children with a moral story, like some of the other stories we've already talked about. But for the most part, they were mostly cautionary tales for adults. So my favourite version of Cinderella, I have a lot of favourite versions of Cinderella, but my absolute favourite version of Cinderella comes from a man by the name of Gian Battista Basile. He was publishing in Neapolitan in 1634, so way older than Perrault. In Basile's version of Cinderella, we get these morals, things like a husband is warned about being too picky about his second or third wife. He gives a general warning to the household about choosing your housekeeping staff carefully. He gives a warning to parents about treating children fairly, which is quite a modern concept, I think. And he gives a warning to young women about being proud. And that's actually before we even get to the bit Disney likes. So, of course, the bit Disney likes is if you're a good person, good things will happen to you, right? There's also the opposing moral, and many of the versions of Cinderella slam home the opposing moral, which is if you're a bad person, bad things will happen to you. In many versions of the stories, both the stepsisters mutilate their feet to fit the slipper, with the associated blood and gore that you would expect from that event. Many of them also get their eyes pecked out by birds at Cinderella's wedding. Particularly gruesome, often it's a gruesome combination of the two, or some other third thing. As for horrifying fairy tales, though, and I am on a bit of a... This is a personal favourite of mine. If you've read anything by Hans Christian Andersen, you will know what a gruesome fairy tale sounds like. The Little Match Girl had me awake for about a week. So, for a long time, though, getting back to the point, what we know now is as fairy tales being, you know, very, very calm stories and delightful stories for children, were really just the easiest and most entertaining way for a largely illiterate population to be able to record and share moral stories and warnings. I really want to make a quick note. There's this ribbon that runs through all of these things. It's the idea of the master and the apprentice. These types of relationships began in Europe in the 1300s, and they're basically a way for a trade person to get cheap labor. But they're also a way for a young apprentice to get a bed to sleep on, a hot meal at the end of the day, and the hope of a trade later on. So this system was used throughout Europe and England for all skilled trades, from seamstresses and blacksmiths to knights and squires. However, the general principles of apprenticeships exist throughout the world, and one of the earliest examples is the idea that we have illustrated here of the Meiko. It's basically a trainee geisha. Geisha have existed in Japan since around 700. They predate a lot of European history, and they still take in Meiko to this day. It's extremely unbroken. I know this isn't written knowledge, but I feel it's an important footnote when we're discussing the history of content, as this was the main way that specialized technical knowledge was handed down. Of course, a young apprentice, wishing to remember all the things that they had learned, might be inclined to write them down. By the time the Industrial Revolution was in full swing, paper and books had become affordable, schooling was more available to children throughout Europe, and literacy was much more widespread, especially to those bright young apprentices who had left home to seek their fortunes. While young people have written home to their families since ancient times, letter writing really hit its stride around the turn of the century, when it became not just a way to record your day and connect with your family, but it was also a way to explore complicated political and religious matters. Also to explore emotions. Poison pens, love letters, and obituaries are all very well represented in letter writing from this period. It's kind of like blogging, kind of like we do now. So another form of writing, more like the manuals we know today, of course, is the recipe book. Who here has a family recipe or a family recipe book? Yes, excellent. It was about half or two-thirds of the audience. I do. We have a choc chip biscuit recipe that's been handed down for at least five generations. Admittedly, I now make it with those mini M&Ms, not choc chips, but everything's a remix, right? So, enough history, as much as that was fun. Let's take a look at some more recent forms of technical communication. Recently, there we go. So these are pretty much all of our yesterdays. In some ways, as a writer, it still feels as though you're not a real writer, unless you've got your name on the outside of an actual book made out of dead tree, sent from some printer. I chose a picture of O'Reilly Books here on purpose, because OpenStack, the project that I work on, finally, last year, decided to ditch our final printed O'Reilly book. OpenStack books are no longer printed on dead tree. Personally, as far as dead tree books go, I am part of the problem. When I'm writing, I actually do like to rely on that paper book sitting on my desk to look things up, especially for things like style guides and dictionaries. Because I don't know about you, but when I'm writing, I'm working on something, and I go and do an internet search, hello, Twitter. As for writing dead tree books, though, nah. I really like the idea of being able to catch and fix problems even after publication. Nevertheless, though, printed books, especially printed technical manuals, are our history, they're our present, and they will be, to some extent at least, our future. A close cousin of the printed manual, white papers are caught somewhere between marketing material and technical documentation. In digital form, I don't think they're going to go away anytime soon, maybe sadly. But the printed white paper, I am hoping, I'm dearly hoping that the printed white paper has been consigned to the recycling bin. As an aside, the very first piece of technical writing I ever did was a white paper. I had a marketing undergraduate degree and half an MBA at the time. So it was a fairly logical piece of writing for me to be doing. I actually enjoyed it immensely, and I immediately set out to become the white paper expert, intending to build a career around this. Thank goodness I discovered technical documentation in the meantime. I was saved from a life of writing white papers. Show of hands, who here is involved in producing technical training manuals or technical training material of any description? Keep your hand up if there is no online component. I think nearly every single person just put their hand back down. Nice work. Face-to-face training has its benefits. Obviously, we've been doing face-to-face training here this week. It has its benefits, and it's unlikely to go away anytime soon. When it comes to teaching technical skills, though, online is where it's moving to, and we will come back to this point in a little while. Finally, in the recent category, I have a screenshot from my very own project. The OpenStackers may recognize this. This is, for all intents and purposes, an online version of a printed book. It has a table of contents down the side. It's divided into chapters and sections. It's designed to be read from beginning to end. It has simple concepts at the beginning, more complicated procedures as you move through, and it has reference information at the end, things like tables of data and a glossary. These have all been great methods of getting information out there, but they're all destined to become as archaic as those cave paintings we looked at earlier and the fairy tales. Let's take a look at those things that we're doing a little differently today and that will drive the way we revolutionize and improve content management in the future. Oh, there's my clicky. There we go. First of all, I want to briefly touch on MOOCs. We discussed technical training, face-to-face training, and these are the future of that. MOOCs not only allow people all around the world to study where and when they choose, but it also allows institutions to create online tools that mimic real-world scenarios. Basically allows students to learn real skills in a safe environment. This is great especially for the tech industry, where students can work on realistic IT setups that they might not be able to recreate in their own environment. OpenStack uses this method a lot. But it also works well for teaching other knowledge work skills. Things like customer service and financial skills are all taught through MOOCs as well. The main thing, though, that I think changed the way we look at how we deliver the information we're creating was data typing. So this is a process of breaking your content into categories. The most popular method of data typing is DITA, D-I-T-A. I apologize to the Americans in the audience. My accent seems to make me unable to say DITA in a way that Americans can understand it. So D-I-T-A is what I'm talking about. That stands for the Darwin Information Typing Architecture. And the DITA breaks content into concepts, tasks, and reference. So these are often described as, what is it, how do I do it, and what else do I need to know? This allows writers to organize their content in a logical way, but it also allows us to pare down that content to the most important bits. It actually does make us better writers. The really interesting part, though, is that it allows us to store snippets of information in a database. Once we've broken the content up into these logical pieces, we can store them with metadata and effectively remix them on the fly. It's also important to note that data typing isn't a new thing. DITA was named in 2001, and it was formalized in 2005. But we've been doing this type of thing, data typing, and similar methods of content organization since the 60s and 70s. This is not new. It became especially popular in the 90s when Joanne Haykos published her book, Managing Your Documentation Project, which I'm sure many of us are familiar with. It got re-released several years later under the title Information Development. This is a book that most tech writers would have on their shelf. I can see a couple of nods in the audience. I've got both of them. I refer to them regularly. They may seem dated in a lot of ways, but they have some very good information in them still to this day. So DITA was really the first, even though we've been doing data typing for a long time, DITA was really the first formal open standard that let us consistently and accurately categorize data into formal types. So it was also simple enough, which was the trick, I think. It was simple enough that we could learn it easily, we could apply it easily, and above all, we could teach others. If any of you have been to any of my tech writing talks in the past, you would have heard me talk about something along these lines of the concept task reference. Even if you're a writer and you're not using a specific DITA tool, there's a very good chance that DITA is actually underpinning any tooling system that you're using. They're all based on this, is where it all stems from. The main driving principle behind data typing, besides the categorization that we were just talking about, the main driving principle is about content reuse and single sourcing. So this is another key component of how we're changing the way we look at content. It's not about a beginning and an end anymore. With this idea, we actually walked away from that age-old idea of telling a story. And we moved towards what I think is a critical period of considering what information is required where and when. This was important mostly because we were actually starting to consider how people consumed information and how people learned difficult concepts. We no longer assume that information we gave to people in the beginning of a book was retained in their head and used to build on that on the later task and later concepts. Sometimes learners need to go over information again and again before they learn. Conversely, more skilled learners wanted to be able to dip into the content at a later point. They didn't need those early concept information. Also, once you've taught somebody this stuff, once they know those things, they may want to come back to it as reference material. They're not going to worry about the concepts anymore. They just want to remember, oh, hold on, what do I do next? What does that command look like? Because we wanted to start giving users more flexibility about how they approached technical documentation, we needed to be able to deliver the same content in a myriad of different ways. One of the main ways that we do this, so we use our database full of our data typed information, and we can deliver several different deliverables from that content. One of the most common ways of doing this is to use the same information to write a user manual as we use to create the online help content. It's because we've got those chunks of information that we can deliver however we like. What we do is we tag each piece of content with a series of metadata, and we can then use that metadata to remix it on the fly according to the user's needs. And that leads me to perhaps my favorite topic right now. Aside from reading the old fairy stories, of course. The best name I can come up with for this is user-side content curation. Curation. It's an extension of the data typing model, but what it does is shift the onus for curation completely away from the writer and onto the user. One of the best ways to think about this is in terms of a Wikipedia page. The articles are organized with simple concept information at the top and more technical information further down, just like a traditional story, but the difference is in the links. As you read a Wikipedia article, you can click on the things that you need more information on. And I'm sure all of us have done this. And next thing you know, it's 4 hours later and you're finding out about some random character from a Doctor Who episode from 1973. We've all done that. The point, though, that I'm trying to make is that that page contains only specific information to that topic. Any extra information that the reader needs, they're given options for getting that information elsewhere. There is no beginning to Wikipedia, and there is certainly no end. Another good example of user-side curation is sites like carsales.com.au. These sites have hundreds of thousands of cars for sale. If you consider each car, each entry, as a piece of content, you can then manipulate the content that you want to receive by checking the boxes on the side. You know, want to see cars less than 5 years old, manufactured by Toyota, only in green, only with an automatic transmission, and only within 10 kilometers of my home. You can filter the content on any number of criteria to see content that is relevant and interesting to you as an individual. Aside from these couple of specific examples, I haven't yet come across a good tool for doing this with large sets of technical documentation. If you find one, let me know. I will continue looking. So this leads to the big question. What does the future hold for content? I think that there are a few main themes that we can tease out of our little documentation history that we've had here, our little journey. First of all, the internet is making things possible that never were before. The idea of being able to give people large data sets and allow them to filter through it themselves is quite unique. Number two, control over content is shifting from those who produce it to those who consume it. The power is shifting. And finally, consumers are used to being able to search vast resources for content and filter those results themselves. They don't want us to tell them what they need to know. Since humans first picked up a bit of burnt stick in a cave, in one form or another, we've been telling stories. Now we have the technology that allows people to create their own stories, not just have one told to them. In many ways, I think this shows a maturation of human development. We're no longer willing to receive whatever is told to us, whatever is given to us. We want to create our own realities, and we have the tools to be able to do that. But that's a massive challenge, a massive challenge. I would also argue that it is a massive opportunity for technical writers. We get to break new ground. And thankfully, we've been working on the building blocks of this for a really long time. The challenge is to start delivering documentation in a completely new way without leaving our organizations, our management, or our more stubborn clients behind. Nobody said breaking new ground would be easy. Every single one of the pieces of content that we've looked at today had its detractors, from everyday concerned citizens, right up to the literati and royalty. Right now, it seems to me that where we could go next is almost infinite. People have always created and consumed content. As long as we continue to put the information out there and give people the tools they need to find that content, they will continue to do so. I've heard a lot of technical writers over the years worry that our industry is dying and there's going to be no jobs, that all our jobs are going to go. I don't believe we are at the end of a journey. I also don't believe we're at the beginning of one. We are merely at a step along a very, very long road, and I'd like to find out where that leads us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's working?
Yeah, thank you very much, Lana. Does anyone have any questions?
Thanks. More and more I'm finding that the technical resources and tutorials online are video based, which personally frustrates me because I can't easily skip to where I want to be, but it seems to be getting more and more popular. I was wondering, do you think that the text versions are dying? Is video taking over?
No, I don't believe that text is dying for exactly the reason you just said. Video is really annoying. I know a lot of people do like videos, and there's definitely been a trend towards video content. But if you recall, I was talking about the different ways that people use that information. People interact with documentation in many different ways. We don't read it as a story anymore. Sometimes we do, but not every time. People want to be able to dip into it. They want to be able to go straight to the piece of information that's useful to them, and video doesn't allow us to do that. Maybe in the future, video will allow us to do that and we can do it that way, but at the moment, I don't believe it's filling that need. There are certainly people who enjoy watching videos to learn things, and there are definitely things. I've gone to YouTube to find out how to do something. I do a lot of cake decorating, and watching someone do that on a video is much easier than reading a document about it, but I don't believe it fits every need, and no, I don't believe writing is dying at all. I'd just like to mention too, I do have references and a lot of further reading. That's just on a Google Doc, and if you hit that into your browser, there's a lot of links there for you to click and find out more.
So, could you tell us a little bit more about how you see the role of the technical writer, or as some like to call it, the technical communicator, in the new future? The ways we used to do things are no longer as useful as they could be. And there's also, though, the worry that if our users can just create the content and then access the content, that we're going to be out of jobs.
To be honest, we may be. Maybe we don't have the skills. Maybe the tech writers of today don't have the skills to be able to do what is required tomorrow. I'm sure there will be a subset of us who are able to learn those skills and become the tech writers of the future or the technical communicators of the future. I don't think we're going to die. I don't think we're going anywhere.
Any further questions?
What about at the back? Anybody waving in the dark back there?
No, they're just escaping real quick. Oh.
Thank you. Maybe come over here because the speaker there might cause feedback.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to go very well. Yeah. Go up to heaven and take my
microphone. Thanks. I'm wondering what we're losing by fragmenting this stuff. I'm wondering, the brain is particularly evolved around that narrative structure, so where does that kind of fit in? And the contextual things that we're losing with that, because once upon a time, authority came with story, came with access to a public. I guess that's sort of a kind of a mushy way of saying, what are we losing with this new sort of structure?
I think it's democratised. I actually think it's becoming available to more people, not less. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if I can answer your question very well. I don't think we're losing anything. I think it's fragmenting, and yeah. I think it may become harder to find. But I also suspect as humans we'll get better at doing that. We've never had to do this before.
Yeah.
We've never had to create our own stories before. And now, of course, we have anti-vaxxers and all that kind of thing who are creating their own narratives in strange ways sometimes. So I think we will get better at that. I think we'll get better at creating those stories and finding that information. And I think the tools will evolve as well. At the moment, Google is very scattergun. You can find all sorts of things, and a lot of it isn't relevant. I do suspect that we will get better at honing that over time.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think I can probably say thank you.
All right, thank you all very much. And on behalf of the organizers, I'd like to present Lana with the speaker gifts.
Sorry, I got distracted. Thank you.
There you go. Thank you very much.
Thank you.